This is Fox 31 Now.
Good morning. Thank you so much for tuning in to Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Happening now, we are getting a media briefing on COVID-19 from Dr. Rachel Herlihy and Scott Bookman with CDPHE. Let's go ahead and listen in.
And Dr. Rachel Herlihy, our state epidemiologist, will start with Dr. Herlihy.
Good morning. Thank you so much for being here. I want to provide a quick update on our case trends in the state. We do continue to see consistent improvement in really all of our data indicators at this point. So here showing you our case trends, you can see this red line showing our 7-day moving average number of cases. We've really seen a really steep continued decline in the number of cases that we're seeing here in Colorado. That number, that 7-day moving average number of cases has been averaging around 3,000 for the last few days. And that is below the level that we saw in both our November, December 2020 and November and December 2021 waves of illness. So certainly continuing to see good progress being made with our case numbers. Case numbers do continue to still be high, so lots of transmission still occurring, but obviously significant improvements being made. Next slide, please. Similarly, we continue to see a really rapid decline in our percent positivity value in the state. That value is currently just below 11% at 10.86%. Again, you can see that we've come down a long way since our peak several weeks ago when we were at 29%. We have that goal of 5% shown on this figure. So we know that we still have a ways to go until we get to lower percent positivity or goal percent positivity levels. But again, steady improvements being made. Next slide, please. And we continue to also see improvements in our hospitalization trends. You can see our current value is 861 COVID-19 hospitalizations in the state as of yesterday. Again, you can see clear improvements from several weeks ago where we had our significant peak nearing that level we had seen during November and December of 2020. But again, substantial improvements made. Next slide, please. And looking at the difference in hospitalization rates across the country right now, you can see here that Colorado is actually doing quite well. We have the 8th lowest rate of hospitalizations in the U.S. right now, based on a 7-day average number of individuals currently hospitalized. So we are doing quite well. Again, reminder that hospitalization rates are still, of course, higher than we want them to be. They're higher than they've been at sort of our low levels of transmission at periods in between the peak values that we've experienced with these large waves that have occurred, but certainly lots of improvements being made, and Colorado is doing quite well when compared to other states across the country. And with that, I will hand it over to Director Bookman.
Thank you, Dr. Herlihy. Thanks, everybody, for joining us here this morning for this update. And to continue on from Dr. Herlihy's remarks, we do continue to see improvements in the capacity of our healthcare system, continuing to see increasing numbers of ICU and medical surgical beds that are available as case counts and hospitalizations do continue to go down. And so, continued optimism in this area. Simultaneously, if you look to the right side of that graph here, you really do see how long we have had elevated hospitalizations in Colorado. And when you put the Delta wave and the Omicron wave together, our hospitals have been under stress for a significant period of time. Our first responders, our healthcare workers on the front lines have been taking care of an enormous amount of COVID patients for the last several months. And I do want to take a moment to acknowledge their exhaustion on the front lines. And with that, what we've heard from many healthcare workers is kind of an increasing level of verbal and sometimes even physical assaults against healthcare providers. And really do want to just take this moment to ask all Coloradans to remember that we are in this together. Our healthcare workers are our heroes on the front lines, and really do want to treat them with the civility and the respect that they deserve. Next slide. So another thing that we can do for ourselves, for our families, for our friends, our loved ones, and for our healthcare workers and our first responders is to make sure that we are up to date on our vaccinations. Now, Coloradans have done an amazing job We are 10th in the nation for the percentage of Coloradans who are up to date in their vaccine. What that means is having received the second dose, if you got your J&J as your first dose, and it means getting a third dose if you had received one of the mRNA vaccines, the Pfizer or the Moderna. And while we are doing well, as of yesterday, 24% of our population is still due for a third dose. And I want to really emphasize the importance of being up to date with your vaccine. The data shows that Coloradans who have received their third dose of their mRNA, a second dose after their J&J, they are 12 times less likely to be hospitalized and 56% less likely, or 56 times less likely to die from COVID than unvaccinated Coloradans. 56 times less likely to die if you're up to date on your immunizations. And so the vaccine is free, it is safe, it is effective, it is widely available, and the data is clear about the importance of making sure that you're up to date. If any questions about where you can go to get your next dose of the vaccine, you can go to our website. There are links there to providers to ensure that you know where you can get vaccinated. And for anybody who hasn't taken the opportunity to get their first dose, now is a great day to do it. Next slide. And in addition to our vaccination efforts, testing remains a key strategy to ensure that people know when they have COVID and have the ability to stay home to prevent spreading it to others. One of the key tools here has been our free rapid at-home testing program. Colorado was the first in the nation to put together a program like this. And as of today, more than 2 million tests have been distributed through this program to Coloradans, giving them the opportunity to know whether they have COVID or whether they don't have COVID. The tests are free. They're mailed directly to you, and each order contains two rapid at-home tests. You can go to our website on the slide here to get more information and to sign up to have the test shipped to your home. The tool is most effective when you have it at your disposal so that if you have been exposed or you wake up and you're not feeling well, you have the tests immediately available to you. All right, Brian, I think it's back to you.
Thank you so much, Director Bookman and Dr. Herlihy. We'll move to the media Q&A portion of this morning's press conference. We'll use the raise hand function. You can locate that along the bottom of the Zoom console. We'll start with first questions first, please. If we have time for second questions or follow-ups, we can certainly come back to those, time permitting. State your name and your outlet before asking your question, please. And if there's anything we're unable to get to, please email us at media_info@state.co.us. Let's go ahead and start things off with Sarah Flower.
Hi, good morning. Sarah Flower here with KDUR. This is all really good, promising information that we're seeing, and certainly states across the nation are lifting mask mandates. Dr. Herlihy and Scott, I'm curious how this conversation switches from a pandemic to an endemic. Are we there yet? And how are things sitting by you?
Oh, that's a great question. And we're certainly seeing a lot of these conversations happening at the international level, at the national level, and we are, of course, having them in Colorado. This virus is very unpredictable. Every time we think we know what's going to happen with it, it has changed on us over the course of the last 2 years. But the modeling is pretty clear that we're likely to have a high level of immunity in our state over the next several months, barring any variant that comes up that has the ability to break through that. And so, we are looking at what do the next several months look like? What are the right strategies to work through that period? And then also thinking about, what might be required again into the fall and into the winter. If there is evidence of waning immunity, there may be needs for additional shots to keep people up to date on their vaccination. And so we're really working through any number of different scenarios so that we can respond to the right moment. And in the coming weeks, that right moment is, being in a spot where we have a high level of immunity. Come fall, we may need to do something different.
Let's go to Ivan Rodriguez.
Good morning. This is Ivan with Denver 7. Sort of just following up on that question, specifically though with schools, I wanted to get your guys' perspective just on how we're seeing a lot of shift when it comes to masking specifically in schools. And we're seeing this across the state and across the country. You know, CDC, you go to their website, it still says it's recommended, even if you're vaccinated, to wear a mask indoors. How are you guys sort of looking at this from just a public health perspective across the state?
Well, first and foremost, I have my mask right here. And regardless of what mandates may or may not exist, I wear my mask when I'm indoors. It protects me and it protects others. Local control is a critical component of where we are right now. We support our local partners who are making evidence-based decisions as they see where things are in their communities. We also are looking at our school's guidance and preparing to issue updated guidance for schools as we look at a period of time where masks will no longer be a tool to break transmission in the schools through that guidance. But again, we do continue to encourage people to wear a mask indoors, regardless of whether there is a mandate.
All right, let's go to Meg Wingerter.
Hello, this is Meg Wingerter from the Denver Post. Dr. Herlihy, you said about hospitalizations are still higher than you would like to see them. Is there a goal at this point? Are we trying to get back to, summer levels, or is it more just we don't have a specific number, 800 plus is too high?
Yeah, so certainly I feel like 800 Coloradans being in the hospital right now is not our ideal state for COVID-19. We'd certainly like to see that number come down quite a bit. We really don't want individuals to have severe outcomes associated with COVID-19 and to be in the hospital. And so I think this also reinforces the importance of vaccination and the message today about the importance of booster doses for preventing death, preventing infection, preventing hospitalization. Really, that continues to be our key strategy to try and decrease the number of hospitalizations that are occurring in Colorado. So I think we have a ways to go with getting those numbers down. To put it in perspective, the numbers that we saw between waves of illness have been closer to 200 or 300. And so certainly that would be a much more comfortable place for us to get to. But we don't want any Coloradans hospitalized.
All right, let's go to Alex Rose.
Alex Rose here with Fox 31. Thanks as always for holding these briefings. We're approaching that mid-February milestone where modeling data suggests that Coloradans across the board should have 80% immunity come mid-February based on our vaccine numbers and also natural immunity. Looking at the data, are you guys able to kind of corroborate that? Because I know that is just a model. But does the data suggest that we are close to 80% immunity as a state from this virus? Thank you.
Yeah, so we are continuing to work closely with our modeling team to update those estimates. That work is underway right now. So, we hope to have more information about where we are compared to those projections from several weeks ago very soon.
All right, let's go to Mallory Anderson.
Hi, Mallory Anderson from KRDO here. New data released by the State Health Department yesterday shows breakthrough cases of COVID kind of skyrocketed during the Omicron surge, even for those who were boosted. Can you touch on this new data? And what would you say to unvaccinated people who see those trends and believe it means they should remain unvaccinated?
Yeah, I really think the most important takeaway from that data is exactly what Director Bookman shared during the presentation today, which is that we see substantial protection from booster doses for preventing severe illness. So really incredible numbers in that risk difference associated with death or with hospitalization between those that have received booster doses and those that are unvaccinated. Director Bookman shared that individuals that are boosted have received that third dose are 56 times less likely to die of COVID-19 than individuals that are unvaccinated. And that's a really staggering difference of risk between those two populations. So again, booster doses, those third doses really continue to be the best way to prevent severe disease outcomes.
All All right, let's go to Chris Vanderveen.
Chris Vanderveen with Nine News. My question is in relation to the booster data that you shared, and clearly you are still encouraging people who have not gotten their boosters to get boosters, but I'm wondering if there was a missed opportunity in the state of Colorado and around the country when it comes to people who are over the age of 65. It looks like, according to your own data, 75% to 80% of people who died in the Omicron, who've died in the Omicron wave, were over the age of 60. And yet in the state of Colorado, still 30% of people over the age of 65 have not gotten boosted. This was a population that was very pro-vaccine, and yet they didn't get boosted in the numbers that you needed to. Was there a failure on the part of public health to get that population boosted at a level that would have protected them during the last wave?
So, you know, Chris, we have been working around the clock for the last 2 years to have the most up-to-date information and to protect Coloradans and public health across the country, working to protect the most vulnerable from this virus. Do you think that, you know, at the national level, there were, you know, some confusion initially about when these, what we were calling then, these booster doses, you know, were required. And so, you know, what we do know right now is that, you know, 71% of those who are 65 and up have gotten their booster. And we will continue to do all that we can to publicly message the importance of being up to date on your vaccination, because we do know how incredibly protective it is when compared to those who have only received two doses, and, you know, for those who have not been vaccinated at all.
All right, let's go to Erica Meltzer.
Erica Meltzer from Chalkbeat. This is another question related to schools. In addition, so we've seen a lot of schools lifting their mask mandates, and they're also changing their quarantine procedures, saying that they would only quarantine students if there was already an outbreak. And so I'm curious, what do you think the outcome of this would be? Like, what should we be expecting to see in schools with these relaxed protocols? And then I was curious, with the updates that CDPHE is planning, if you're going to endorse that approach to quarantine.
So we are going to be updating our guidance, hopefully to be released as early as end of this week or into next week. What we know is that we have seen significant, you know, decreases in the rates of illness across our state. As we were talking about the modeling data before, we do believe that we are going to have a high level of immunity for the next several months. And we do know how important it is to normalize school for our children the best that we can, and to support the most optimal in-person learning environment. And so, you know, moving towards a place where you know, masks are not mandated, where quarantine is no longer a routine part of the work that is done. And again, moving back towards a place where COVID is treated more like, you know, other communicable diseases in our schools and in our community is certainly where we are headed at this point. Again, we don't know what the fall is going to look like. Every time we think we know what this virus is going to do, another variant has popped up. And so we're gonna have to be nimble and prepared to respond to any number of different things.
Let's head over to John Daly.
Hi there, John Daly, Colorado Public Radio News. Thanks for taking our questions. I think there's a question for Dr. Herlihy. Wondering if you could talk a little bit about the subvariant of Omicron, what we're seeing with surveillance in Colorado, and what's your level of concern that that Colorado could see that subvariant really take off like has been seen in, you know, a place like Denmark?
Yes, so I believe you're referring to the subvariant BA2, which is obviously closely related to the primary Omicron variant, the BA1 variant that has really been causing most of the illness here in Colorado and in the US. So We continue to see lower numbers of that BA2 variant. It doesn't look like it is taking off to the same degree that it has spread widely in countries like Denmark and to some extent the UK as well. We don't know exactly why that might be. There are discussions right now underway among, you know, molecular scientists who are studying the genetics of these viruses to really try and understand what might be circulating here in the US and how that could potentially be preventing widespread transmission of this BA2 variant. There's another subvariant that is closely related to BA1 called BA1.1 that also seems to be taking off in the US, though it's much more closely related to BA1 than BA2 is. And so because we have that variant, which maybe is less common in Denmark and the UK, that could be a reason we're not seeing as much BA2 here. So a lot of complexity in this, but at this point, it doesn't look like BA2 is having a significant impact in the US.
Great, Seth Klayman, go ahead.
Hi guys, Seth of the Gazette. I'm curious if you can speak to what you're seeing as far as mortality, I'm standing on a street corner if you can hear background. About a third of the state's COVID deaths have come since mid-October, about to pass 12,000. So just curious your thinking on mortality and the trends you've seen, particularly over the last, you know, 6 weeks after Omicron death started. Thanks.
Yes. Yeah, so, as we discussed with the data we presented, we continue to see a much higher risk of deaths associated with being unvaccinated. So this wave, like previous waves, the population that is more likely to die has been unvaccinated individuals. And we've also looked at the average age associated with deaths in this wave compared to previous waves. At least compared to the recent Delta and Alpha waves, we haven't seen a big change in overall average age of those deaths. That original wave we saw with the original Wuhan strain, average age was a little bit older there. So not really seeing a substantial change in demographics in general with deaths, but again, it continues to be primarily the unvaccinated population.
All right, any other first questions? All right, we can take some follow-ups. We'll start with Ivan.
Hello, just wanted to follow up mainly just more on the messaging side of things, not just from the state, but also just from other organizations and school districts. We know that there are going to be more variants that are coming in the future. And how important is it as far as messaging is concerned? You know, just 2-3 weeks ago, we were talking about picking up KN95s and state distribution of them and the importance of wearing that, how helpful those are. And now again, going to, you know, maybe no more masking. How important is that, especially down the line where we may have to backtrack again, like we did last summer, and then revert? How hard is that, and how much are you guys looking into that as just having the public's backing when it comes to those kinds of things?
Well, you know, Ivan, very good question. And, you know, we're here today. We're here every week to partner with you all and make sure that we're doing all that we can to get the message out to all Coloradans. And we know that the last 2 years have been incredibly difficult, that at times it has felt like a seesaw. And, you know, we all have a case of whiplash as we try to understand this virus and how it mutates and how it impacts our lives. First and foremost, we have tools today that we didn't have a year and a half ago. We have safe, effective vaccines. I mean, we've talked about that number, 56 times more likely to die if you are not vaccinated compared to somebody who is up to date on their vaccine. We have therapeutics becoming more and more widely available. We know the importance of medical grade masking. And we also know that it is important to move with the virus as appropriate. And what we see now, what our modelers tell us, is that we are very likely to go into a period where we can live more normally, possibly more normally than we have lived in the last almost 2 years now. And so, you know, we want to tell that to Coloradans. We want to make sure that that story gets out there. Simultaneously, we do want to say that we don't know what will come next. The science on this virus is continuing to evolve. And so we do want to make sure that people know that while the next few months look very promising, it is possible that we will come back to you at another point and have to talk about what measures do we need to take. It is likely that we will need to do additional doses of the vaccine. You know, will we come to a point where we need to put more masks on again? These are all things that we will continue to work with you, work with our partners, and ensure that the public understands where we are today and where we may be in the future.
Let's go back to Meg.
Hello. My second question is about the at-home testing. Correct me if I'm wrong, but as I recall, started, you could order 8 tests with the idea you were supposed to swab yourself twice a week for a month. And then you said about now ordering 2 tests. So is the idea that you want people to just use those if they're, you know, they have an exposure or something specific that they're trying to make sure they're negative for, or is the idea they're supposed to, you know, also order tests from the federal government and get them where they can and keep screening themselves?
Well, we encourage people to use these tests if they are, you know, feeling poorly or they have been exposed. And so, you know, we were sending out a larger amount. What we also know now is that we have a large amount available. And so people do have the ability to have them on hand, either through the federal program or through our program, so that they have this test at their disposal when they need it.
All right, let's go to Alex Rose.
I was really curious about that 24% figure of Coloradans that have been fully vaccinated but have yet to get their booster shot. Is there any way, do you guys know if all that 24% is eligible to receive a booster? Maybe they got fully vaccinated later on in the game. Just wanted to get some clarification on that. Thanks.
Those are people who are eligible by date. So that number constantly changes because the timeline, more people are becoming eligible or less people are becoming eligible, depending on where we are at that point in time. And so that is everybody who could go and get an additional dose today and get themselves that extra level of protection.
All right, let's go back to Sarah Flower.
Any update on children under 5 being vaccinated, as reports are coming in that it's likely this month where at eligibility the EAU will come into place? Is the state preparing for that, or any update on that? Thanks.
Yes. So we are hearing the same information that you all are hearing about a series of meetings that will happen FDA and CDC over the coming weeks. We are preparing for vaccination of that population as early as, in the month of February, possibly as early as President's Day, is when vaccine may become available. And so we are working with all of our providers to encourage them to order this very specific vaccine for this age group. And we are incredibly excited for yet another part of our population. Now almost everyone being eligible to get the vaccine that is so effective.
We got time for one more question. Let's go to John Daly.
I guess this is a question for both of you. The folks in Colorado that are unvaccinated, what's your view, and I don't know if you have any data to share, about whether those, what percentage of those people just will flat out refuse? And what percentage, roughly, do you think are still reachable? And then how do you think the state can reach those additional unvaccinated people?
So, John, I believe everybody is reachable. And our goal here is going to be to continue to work with all of our community partners, our local public health agencies, our healthcare providers, to make sure that we are working to get every Coloradan to step up and take this vaccine that will help protect them and protect their families.
All right, thank you everyone for joining this morning. If you have any questions that we weren't able to get to this morning, please do email us at media_info@state.co.us and we'll get you some information as soon as possible. Thanks again for joining this morning. Thank you, Dr. Herlihy, Director Bookman. Have a good rest of your day.
And thank you folks for tuning into Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. That wraps up the latest COVID-19 update here in Colorado. We can see, and I'll tick through the data as I normally do for those of you who missed the top of that press conference. But in terms of just looking at our state data, cases are down from the Omicron surge that we saw. It's been a full month since the peak in cases here in Colorado. That happened, goodness, drinking coffee this morning, like it's my job. That happened around January 10th. So a month ago, we saw cases peak on average. There was about 13,835 COVID cases detected in Colorado. Now we are all the way down to 2,654. Keep in mind, that is still an incredibly high number. So I've seen a couple people say, hey, you know, I still know a lot of people that still have COVID or have tested positive recently, even though cases are dropping. You gotta keep in mind that the top of that Delta wave that we saw right around Thanksgiving for cases, that was 3,186 cases. Now we're at 2,654. So even though in retrospect, we're certainly nowhere near where we were at the top of that wave, it's still a pretty high number. So just keep that in mind. Again, we'll go as we normally do through some of the hospital data right now. So looking at this, and I'm in touch with a couple of different hospitals to do stories. 65% of people who are testing positive for COVID in our hospitals right now are currently unvaccinated. But unfortunately, this data doesn't delineate between who is in the hospital because of COVID or just with COVID. We know that incidental COVID has become more of a factor with Omicron, people showing up with a broken leg or in need of a kidney transplant and happen to test positive for the virus. And so that is becoming certainly more of a factor in this data, and it's harder for us to be able to decipher it. But look at these hospital numbers of below 1,000 for the first time really since mid-October is when we haven't seen those COVID levels in the hospital this low since October. So that's also good news. Again, all this is publicly available at covid19.colorado.gov/data. And it's a lot of the data that you see in these briefings every week from the folks over at CDPHE. That's going to do it for me here on Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Again, thank you so much for tuning in. Hope you folks have a great rest of your day. Take care.